Lesson number 10 of Ethics, Governance and Sustainability. Firstly, let us look into the scope of this particular chapter. So this lesson discusses on the corporate governance requirements in the banks, insurance companies and also public sector companies. The scope includes the board composition of the board under the SBI Act 1955, Banking Companies Act and the Banking Regulation Act 1947. Along with it, we will also deal with the Ganguly Committee and the Basel Committee. This is with respect to corporate governance in banks. In respect of insurance companies, we will see what are the corporate governance guidelines in insurance companies given by ADI, and then corporate governance in public sector enterprises by the Department of Enterprises, and finally CSR and sustainability for central public enterprises. Right, so this is what we are going to discuss in this particular lesson. Firstly, let us look into the board composition requirements under SBI Act 1955, Banking Companies Act 1970 and Banking Regulations Act 1949. So under SBI Act 1955, so now before we even go into it, firstly let me give you a disclaimer that this chapter is basically pertaining to remembering of the compositions, remembering of certain provisions. So this is not a technical, this is not something which is technical in nature, this is something which a student is expected to remember. So what we did through our virtual law is that we try to concise, so what are the requirements of under the various acts given under your material, we try to concise it and put it in a form which is easy for you to remember. So adopt this topic in that nature, right? So now firstly, now let me start off with this particular topic. So under SBI Act 1955, firstly the chairman shall be appointed by the central government in consultation with the RBI, which means this is pertaining to State Bank of India. So for State Bank of India, which is again a bank, the chairman of the State Bank of India, the chairman of the board of the State Bank of India shall be appointed by central government in consultation with the RBI. And the central government in consultation with the RBI can appoint a maximum of 4 managing directors. One director can be appointed from employees of SBI who shall be a workman. One director who shall not be a workman, again from employees of SBI. 2 to 6 directors nominated by central government who shall have the knowledge in the field of banking. One director can be nominated by central government who can be anyone who can be nominated by central government. And finally, one director on recommendation from the RBI shall be nominated by the central government. So this is the board composition requirement as per the SBI Act for State Bank of India. Next, for other banks, that is for other banking companies, Acquisition Transfer of Undertaking Act under that particular act. So there can be maximum 4 whole-time directors. So it's not managing director, but whole-time directors by central government in consultation with the RBI. One director who shall be a central government official nominated by the central government. One director on recommendation from RBI having expert knowledge in banking field. One director from employees who is a workman. One director from the employee who is not a workman. So there is a bit of similarity under these two acts. Under the Banking Regulations Act 1949. So this Banking Regulations Act 1949 is applicable for all the banks. So this gives a criteria, this does not give the specific thing, right? So the criteria under prescribed under Board Banking Regulations Act 1949 is that the majority of the directors shall have expert knowledge in banking. None of the directors other than the chairman of the whole-time director, so no other director other than the chairman of the whole-time director shall hold office of directorship continuously for a period exceeding 8 years. So maximum period is 8 years. Next, whenever the office of the chairman or managing director is vacant, RBI, that is the Reserve Bank of India, has the power to appoint any other person as the chairman or managing director for such banking company. The chairman or managing director so appointed by the RBI will have to hold office for a period not exceeding 3 years, but again he shall be eligible for reappointment. So these are the requirements under the Banking Regulations Act 1949. Right? So there is one more differentiation and one more thing which we need to deal. In this slide, we are going to discuss about the requirement of number of directors based on the non-government shareholders, based on the percentage of shareholding of the non-government shareholders under SBI Act and also under Banking Companies Act 1970. So what is this pertaining to? So this is pertaining to deciding or determining the maximum number of directors you can have, which is based on the percentage of shareholding of your non-government shareholders. So in a government bank, other than the government, there are also non-government shareholders. So such non-government shareholders, their percentage of shareholding will decide the number of directors that particular bank shall have. If you look at the SBI Act, where your non-government shareholders are holding having shareholding less than 10%, then maximum 2 directors you need to have other than the managing director or chairman. If it is 10 to 25% minimum, sorry, it's not maximum, sorry, minimum. Minimum 3 directors you need to have. If it is more than 25%, you need to have minimum 4 number of directors. Under the Banking Companies Act 1970, where your non-government shareholders are less than 16%, minimum 1 director you need to have other than main director or chairman. Where 16 to 32% minimum 2 number of directors other than the main director and chairman. And where it is exceeding 32% is minimum 3 number of directors other than the main director or chairman. So this is the requirement for number of directors under these two acts. So with this we have covered the concept of composition of board of directors under the three acts, that is SBI Act, Banking Companies Act and Banking Regulations Act. Now let us look into what recommendations were received by the Ganguly Committee, which was constituted for the purpose of enhancing or like identifying the requirement of significance of corporate governance in the banking sector. So the Ganguly Committee has been constituted with a view of having recommendations in terms of corporate governance guidelines for banking companies. So what are the recommendations of the Ganguly Committee? So firstly, Ganguly Committee had recommended in terms of the responsibilities of the board, which include overseeing the risk profile of the bank, because banks have a lot of risk which they need to face in terms of providing of loans or some other instruments. Hence, overseeing such risk profile should also be responsibility of the board, monitoring the integrity of the business of the banks and maximizing the interest of the shareholders shall be the responsibilities of the board. And the role of independent directors or non-institute directors has been emphasized by the Ganguly Committee. The Ganguly Committee recommended that there shall be more of independent directors and non-institute directors on the board of the bankings, of the banks. The directors shall be trained to familiarize with respect to the functions of the bank. The committees, particularly the shareholders redressal committee, risk management committee and supervisory committee, shall be constituted by the banks and their role shall be emphasized by the banks. The minutes of the board meetings shall be forwarded to the directors within 48 hours of the meeting is what is the recommendation of the Ganguly Committee. And finally, disclosures pertaining to progress made in implementation of risk management system, exposures to banks related entities. So, you know, what kind of exposures the bank has in respect of its own related party entities. And finally, compliance with corporate governance standards. These minimum disclosures have to be made to the board of directors of every bank. So these are the recommendations of Ganguly Committee in general for all the banks. However, Ganguly Committee also has a separate set of recommendations exclusively for public sector enterprises. Let us look into what those recommendations are. So to the public sector banks, firstly, it wants the information flow to the bank, to the board of directors, has to be improved. Second, a compliance officer who is preferably a company secretary has to be appointed so that he takes care of the compliance of the entire bank. For nominating the directors onto the board, there shall be a policy, there shall be an eligibility criteria. And finally, the composition of the board shall be such that it takes into picture the requirements of the banking sector and also the requirements of the industry in which the bank's business is basically operated. So these are the recommendations of the Ganguly Committee specifically to public sector banks. So this Ganguly Committee had played a crucial role in terms of enhancing the corporate governance guidelines for all the banks. So in addition to the Ganguly Committee, we have one more international committee which deals with banking, so which is the Basel Committee. So the Basel Committee on Corporate Governance firstly has come up with Basel First Report, which was adopted by India in the year 1992. So this year 1992 marked the year for LPG, which is liberalization, privatization and globalization, right? LPG. So this is the year where India has opened its markets for world to come on. However, the same year, no, during the year 1992, there were many scams and many scandals in the US financial market, and hence based on, you know, in order to ensure the same things should not be faced by the country India, they have adopted the Basel First Committee on Corporate Governance in the year 1992. Later, Basel Second Report has come in order to ensure that the deficiencies whichever have been identified in Basel One have to be removed. You know, they have released, they've come up with the first version in 1999, however, released the final version in 2004. It had three basic goals, which is firstly to promote adequate capitalization of banks. Secondly, encouraging improvements in risk management, which has been felt the need of the hour for every bank. And finally, to strengthen the stability of financial systems. So in order to strengthen the stability of financial system, that is why you have got more of the KYC norms or other filling of forms, submission of various documents as identity proofs, etc., etc., have been emphasized or enhanced only after adoption of these Basel second committee by India. And finally, Basel third committee, which is the current report which India had adopted, it has been released in 2010. However, RBI had issued guidelines on applicability or on the Basel third reforms in the year 2012, particularly on May 2nd, and these reforms were in respect to capital regulation for all the banks. So these have been implemented with effect from April 1st, 2013, even though they have been adopted on May 2nd, they have been implemented on April 1st because that's the financial year. And they implemented it in various phases. And the goal is to fully implement the Basel III Committee by the end of 2019, which is March 31st, 2019. Right? So these are the three reports for the purpose of corporate governance in the banks. However, India has further adopted, the Basel committee had come up with certain principles on corporate governance, which has been released for adoption by the countries, by various countries, they can adopt such principles. So what are that principles? Let us discuss on the next slide. The Basel Committee on Banking Supervision has come up with guidelines on corporate governance for the banks. There are in total 13 principles which have been identified. Let us go through the principles one by one. Principle number one talks about the board's overall responsibilities. So this principle stipulates that the board of every bank has the overall responsibility in terms of approving implementation of the bank's strategic objectives and also ensuring or looking into how the management is implementing such objectives in terms of the strategy, and not just the strategy but also the governance framework and the corporate culture. So the bank should firstly keep in place certain corporate culture, should approve various business strategies, and they should also oversee the implementation of the same by the management. So that is what is principle number one. Principle number two is in terms of the qualifications of the board and the composition of the board. So it specifically says that, it does not specify what shall be the qualification of the board, but it specifies that the qualification shall suit their position in the board, position on the board, and they should be well qualified in order to ensure that they are exercising sound objective judgment about the affairs of the bank. So they should be in a position to judge the outcome of a particular event. They should be in a position to exercise sound mechanism in terms of decision making with regard to the affairs of the bank. So that is principle number two. So principle number three, in respect of governance structure of the board, it clearly stipulates that the board of directors shall define its own governance structure and practices, and it shall periodically review the same for having effectiveness of the governance structure. So the board shall firstly formulate its own structure as to how it shall govern the bank, and it shall review it on a periodical basis to ensure that the banking structure or the banking governance structure is effective throughout the governance of the board. And then principle number four pertaining to senior management. So what this principle stipulates is that, other than the board, even the senior management should have proper responsibilities. However, such responsibilities are exercised by the senior management under the direction and oversight of the board. So even though they are the senior management of the banks, they still exercise their powers under the direction of the board and also under the oversight of the board. So they are expected to carry out the bank's activities, manage the bank's activities. They commit themselves for implementation of the business strategies, however, under the supervision of the board of directors of the bank. So again, here through this principle, it is emphasizing that the board has a more responsibility than the senior management. And then the governance of group entities or the group structures. So here under this principle, it clearly stipulates that, this committee stipulated that Now, a bank has various entities, group entities. Say one group for, you know, one bank would, one of its subsidiary may be for mutual funds, one of its subsidiaries for merchant banking services, one of its subsidiaries will only provide loans, one of its subsidiaries will provide loans only for medium, small scale enterprises, right? So either there are various group entities which are headed by this particular bank. So what does this principle say? This principle stipulates that the board of directors or the board of the parent company shall have the overall responsibility for the entire group entities, is what is the recommendation or what is the stipulation under this particular principle. So this particular principle clearly specifies that where a bank has various group entities, it is always the board of directors or the board of the parent company which shall take care of the responsibility of the group entities governance. Next, the principle number 6 pertaining to risk management function. So this principle stipulates that the banks, every bank should have an effective independent risk management function. So risk management function which shall be independent and which shall run under the direction of a chief risk officer. So it recommended or it stipulated that every bank should have a chief risk officer under whose function an effective independent risk management shall take place. The next principle is also pertaining to risk. So it stipulates, this principle is about risk identification, monitoring and controlling. And this stipulates that such identification, monitoring and controlling of risk shall take place on an ongoing basis throughout the bank and throughout the individual entities of the banks, that is all the group entities as well. Keeping in pace the changes in the risk profile faced by the bank. So today the business of the bank may be 100 crores, tomorrow it will be 1000, day after it would be some 10,000 crores, right? So keeping on where there is a more business the bank is generating, the more risk the bank would face. So this risk management in terms of identification, monitoring and controlling shall also keep in pace with the changes in the risk profile faced by the bank. And another principle on a risk is with respect to risk communication. So whenever you're facing a risk, so how do you communicate or to whom do you communicate? So firstly, you need to communicate within the bank, and it is communicated both across the organization, that is across the top management or senior management and across the functionaries, employees of the organization, and also intimated to the board through reporting to the board and also to the senior management. So risk communication shall take place within the organization throughout each and every risk management head or say departmental heads and also to the board and senior management. So these three principles pertain to risk and risk management. The next principle, that is principle number nine, is in terms of compliance risk. So compliance, so what does it say? It says it is the responsibility of the board of directors to manage the compliance risk. So they shall identify what are all the compliance requirements. They shall monitor whether such compliance have been met by the banks or not. And they should also ensure that there is a person, or they shall assign roles for the person who shall be responsible for compliance under the banking structure. So the risk of compliance shall be the responsibility of the board, is what is this principle about. The next principle in terms of internal audit, it says that every bank should have an internal audit done on a periodical basis, and the object of it is to ensure it is to provide independent assurance to the board that yes, the bank is running properly in terms of its policies or also in terms of its principles and other adopted techniques. Next principle, that is principle number 11, is in terms of compensation. So what does this principle say? This principle stipulates that the banks should have an appropriate remuneration structure which should support the corporate governance and risk management. Okay, so the compensation itself should justify that. Suppose the role of a person in terms of corporate governance and risk management, it shall be directly proportional to the pay he is getting. So the better the pay, the better the vigilance the banks can have. So the bank remuneration structure should also take into picture the corporate governance and the risk management obligations of the relevant persons. And then principle number 12 deals with the disclosure and transparency. So it's a general principle. So this stipulates that you need to make adequate disclosures to ensure adequate transparency to all the stakeholders, including shareholders, deposit holders and other interested parties. And finally, principle number 13 is in terms of role of supervisors. So every bank shall have supervisors who shall supervise the implementation of corporate governance at the banks through evaluating the same on periodical basis and having regular interactions with the board and senior management, reporting them as to the implementation of corporate governance in the banks, right? So this is what is principle number 13 in terms of role of supervisor. So these 13 principles have come as recommendations from the Basel Committee on Banking Supervision, or you can call it as guidelines basically on the corporate governance for the banks. So this is one important concept which we need to concentrate. Now let us go through corporate governance guidelines for insurance companies. So we have seen corporate governance guidelines for the banks. So now let us look into the corporate governance guidelines for insurance companies. So again, here under insurance companies, it is IRDAI, that is the Insurance Regulatory Development Authority of India, is the one which stipulates corporate governance guidelines. So the IRDAI, through its circular dated May 18, 2016, has revised its existing corporate governance guidelines to make sure they are in line with the Companies Act 2013. So even here, this is something which we need to remember. Let us look into the major recommendations given or the guidelines given by the IRDAI through the insurance companies. So in terms of corporate governance structure, it stipulates that the existing governance structure should be reoriented, taking into account the risk profile faced by the respective insurance company. The board of directors, each of them should possess the knowledge in the business of the insurer. So suppose it is insurance of life, then each of them should have basic expert knowledge in terms of such particular business, that is life insurance of that particular bank, right? So independent directors, in this guidelines stipulate that for the first 5 years of registration, minimum 2 independent directors is sufficient, but later after 5 years, you should have minimum 3 independent directors on your board. Nextly, in terms of CEO, it states that if your chairman is non-executive, your CEO shall be whole-time director. If your chairman is an executive, then a CEO may or may not be whole-time director. But if your chairman is non-executive, that is not a whole-time person or whole-time employee of the company, in that case, your CEO shall be a whole-time director. The profits committee of LIC, it also stipulated the particulars in terms of the profits committee of LIC, wherein it states that there shall be at least one independent director, CEO of the company, CEO of LIC shall also be a member of such profits committee, actuary of the company shall be a member, and an independent actuary appointed only for a committee for the profits committee of LIC. Right. So what is the role of this profits committee? So this profits committee will look into framing of the policies in such a way which would give certain profit to the LIC. Then it stipulated for certain mandatory committees for the banks, for the insurance companies, which are in terms of audit committee, investment committee, risk management committee, policyholder protection committee, NRC committee, and CSR committee. Under this, investment committee is one thing which we need to make a note of. So investment committee, the terms of reference or the scope of the investment committee is to look into where it can invest the pooled funds from the insurance policy holders. So basically, insurance policy holders dump in a lot of money in the form of insurance policies or insurance premiums, right? And these insurance companies cannot just have the insurance premium idle in their bank accounts. So they have to circulate it through various investments and get more funds, make more money out of the existing investment. So this committee basically deals with such kind of investments, it deals with where to invest the pooled funds, where to invest through, be it mutual funds or securities market or any other government security bonds and all, that will be decided by the investment committee. So these are the mandatory committees stipulated by the IRDAI. If your CEO, MD or whole-time director, the appointment, their appointment, reappointment or termination shall require prior approval of IRDAI. And appointed actuaries, so actuaries is again is a professional who deals in statistics. So IRDAI appointed actuaries regulations 2000 shall be applicable for their appointment and also for their regulation. Right. And finally, the other requirements are statutory auditor. So IRDAI is again empowered to issue directions or guidelines on appointment, continuance or removal of auditors. This outsourcing agreement is something which is very important. So under insurance companies can outsource various things signing of policies. They can engage agents who will go to various people and get the policies signed. And there may be other agents also whom you can outsource only for the purpose of circulation of your policies and all. However, such outsourcing arrangements, all of them shall be approved by the board of directors. And the committee of the KMPs shall also approve such outsourcing arrangements. But the basic function, that is a core function of the insurance company, can never be outsourced. So how, what, you know, what is the best example you can take for outsourcing arrangement? Let us say payment of insurance premium. What other, the person, the insurer is not paying insurance premium. Then you can outsource the process of collection of that funds. A collection of insurance premium can be outsourced to any other agency who will go and collect the funds on your behalf, right? So that is what is outsourcing. But you cannot totally outsource framing of the policy, right? Or getting claims to yourself. So these are certain things which you cannot outsource because they are core functions of the company. But functionalities like outsourcing recovery of money from the insurer, right? Or verifying the property verification can also be outsourced. So you can outsource it to an advocate who will take care of the verification of title over the property. So these are certain things which you can outsource, right? So these outsourcing arrangements have to be approved by the board and also by the committee of KMPs. Finally, there shall be evaluation of the board of directors on a regular basis, which shall be as per the Companies Act 2013. So these are the guidelines recommended or stipulated by the IRDAI through its circular. So these are the guidelines for insurance companies. Now let us look into the corporate governance guidelines for public sector enterprises. So in a public sector enterprises, it is the Department of Public Enterprises which is the department which is liable, or you can say which is responsible for issuing guidelines for public sector enterprises. Let us go through what are the guidelines issued for it. Firstly, in terms of board of directors, it issued guidelines pertaining to composition, number of meetings and other miscellaneous aspects. Under composition, it requires every public sector enterprise. So here we are talking about unlisted public sector enterprises, and again unlisted central public listed public sector enterprises. So these are not for all the public sector enterprises, even the listed ones. So listed ones SEBI shall apply, but these are only for unlisted central public sector enterprises. So under that, it recommends for optimum combination of functional, nominee and independent directors. It does not say how many. And it stipulates that the functional directors cannot exceed 50% of the board. So these functional directors are basically the whole-time directors. The nominee directors shall be restricted to two. So these nominee directors are those directors which are nominated by institutions or by the governments. So they shall not be exceeding two. So this is with respect to composition. And it requires at least one meeting in every 3 months and at least four such meetings in every year. So this is almost on par with the Companies Act. And other miscellaneous things which it recommended are pertaining to the code of conduct. So the board of directors and senior management shall have a code of conduct which they shall comply with on an annual basis. Risk management plan shall be formulated by the board of directors, and they shall ensure that the risk management is taking place in the public sector enterprise. And the directors shall be trained on a periodical basis to make them familiar with the functions of the public sector enterprise. Right? So these are with respect to the board of directors. Nextly, we have provisions with respect to the audit committee, in which it stipulated that the composition of audit committee shall have at least minimum three directors, two-thirds of whom shall be independent directors, and the chairman shall be an independent director. The role of the audit committee is to, in addition to what would be the role prescribed under the Companies Act, which we have discussed on the lesson number 6 pertaining to the committees, competent to committees. In addition to such role, the other roles also includes to follow action taken on audit observations of CAG audit. So CAG comes up with various observations. So what kind of action has been taken by the public sector enterprise in terms of the observations made by the audit, by the CAG, that is Comptroller and Auditor General. And then also to review the follow-up action taken on recommendation of Committee on Public Sector, Committee on Public Undertaking of Parliament. So this is a Parliament's committee, which is Committee on Public Undertaking. So the Parliament has a Committee on Public Undertaking, which gives its recommendations in each of the sessions of the Parliament. So in all the sessions, it comes up with certain recommendations. And how far have those recommendations been taken into purview by the public sector enterprise? A follow-up action has to be reviewed by the audit committee. So these are the two additional roles in terms of public sector enterprises. And just like the board meeting, it also stipulates for audit meetings, audit committee meetings, to have at least four in a year, and there shall be a gap of minimum 4 months between two consecutive meetings. So this is what is the requirement for audit committee. For remuneration committee, it stipulates that there shall be at least three directors, all of whom shall be part-time directors, is what is the wording used. For part-time directors under central public sector enterprises, it implies that they shall be either nominee directors or independent directors. And in addition to it, it also stipulates that the chairman of such remuneration committee shall be an independent director. And finally, about the subsidiary companies. So it requires any one independent director of the company, whoever be an independent director of this company, shall act as a director on the board of subsidiary company. The financials of subsidiary company shall be reviewed by the audit committee of this particular committee of the parent company, that is the central public sector enterprise. And finally, the minutes of the board meetings of the subsidiary shall also be placed before the board of directors of the company. So these are the provisions in terms of subsidiary companies. In addition to it, it also prescribes certain miscellaneous provisions like whistleblower mechanism, evaluation of the board and all. So these are again general in nature, right? So these are the guidelines in terms of corporate governance in central public sector enterprises which are unlisted. Now let us look into the corporate governance guidelines in terms of CSR and sustainability, right? Specifically for central public sector enterprises. So finally, the guidelines on CSR and sustainability for central public sector enterprises. So firstly, it talks about the applicability. Now the applicability is very clear here in terms of CSR. So section 135 comes up with an applicability criteria for CSR committee based on which, again, previous year profits 2% you spend. When it comes to central public sector enterprises, the applicability under 135 is immaterial. The only thing which it stipulates is that if you have profits in a preceding year, then spend something for CSR. That is very clear in terms of central public sector enterprises. This you should remember. If you have profits in your previous preceding year, then you should spend something for your CSR activities. And in terms of spending such CSR activities, you should also have a policy which is in terms of CSR and sustainability. So your policy should talk about what, you know, what is your purview of CSR, what is your perspective of CSR, and the sustainability of the business of your company, and also sustainability of the practices, business practices, and also and sustainability in terms of environment and social aspects. Next, priority. No, it requires this guidelines stipulate that the central public sector enterprise shall prioritize its CSR activities mainly in terms of issues concerning national development. So its CSR activities should aim or target at national development. And it should ensure that whatever be its activities is in terms of business or in terms of environment or in terms of protection of environment or in terms of any other CSR activity or sustainability activity, it shall act in a manner which is socially, environmentally and economically sustainable. And then it shall ensure that it is giving importance to sustainability throughout its life cycle in terms of throughout its manufacture of products or throughout its provision of services, whatever be the activity, it should ensure that it is giving top priority or importance to sustainability. Right? It should engage with the stakeholders, identify its internal and external stakeholders, ensure that it is having proper dialogue with the stakeholders, and it's having alliance, it's making them as alliance or partners in terms of its business decision making. So stakeholder engagement is again an important guideline for central public sector enterprises. So it should ensure well-being of its own employees, right? The employee should feel better and feel that they are working in a better working place. Throughout their employment with the company, they should be provided with proper facilities and proper perquisites. And the concept, even the same concept of the CSR under 135, that is in terms of local area preference. So any of the CSR activities undertaken by the bank, undertaken by central public sector enterprise, it shall ensure that it is giving preference initially or firstly to its local area. And finally, it shall ensure product lifecycle sustainability. So throughout the product's lifecycle, that is right from the cradle to the grave, that is right from the birth to the death of that particular product, right from getting the raw material, procuring the raw material till the finished product and till the consumption of the product, it shall be sustainable in nature. There shall not be any threat to the consumer of the products. So these are the basic guidelines prescribed for central public sector enterprises in terms of CSR and sustainability. So with this, we have finished this lesson. So what I suggest for the students in this particular lesson is that, so this particular lesson is not a technical lesson, as I already stated on the first slide of our discussion. So this lesson is something which is pertaining to remembering of certain things. Now, the basic or the important stuff under this can be like generalized as guidelines in terms of board composition under SBI Act, banking regulations, and Banking Act, right? And then the Ganguly Committee, the Basel Committee, all the three, the principles under Basel Committee, guidelines for insurance companies, and guidelines for central public sector enterprises. So the topics are very clear. So what you need to do is make a note of whatever has been covered in this slide and just revise that before you go to the exam. So that would help you out in recollecting certain info in terms of any of the question asked under this particular topic, right? Thank you.